woke up not feeling this morning. Last night she packed her things up, I watched her leave. I read the note that you left out on the counter. Still hear your voice inside my head, it cuts deep. Now I'm free. Talk now. She's not a surgeon, but she really took my heart out. Love sick, got me feeling nauseous. Gave you my mind and you won't fill it up with nonsense. I guess you made up your mind. I know it, I could tell by the look in your eyes. I woke up not feeling this morning. Last night she packed her things up, I watched her leave.
And welcome everybody to the NABART commentary. Your main commentator was inactive, so we are here. My name is Emmett Freeman with Rap Bastard and Lamb Pipe. They're going across some of the turns here with the pace car. Of course, with Autumn Hill here, it's going to be a lot different than some of the races that you have seen so far with Daytona. The bait ran here just about yesterday. So be ready on that. And, well, first I'm going to get to some questions. Rat Bastard, do you have any picks for the win here at Autumn Hill?
You know, somebody I would watch out for is the 2X of Tyler King. He's not really starting for the front here, but he won it last year. He's always fast. He likes these road courses, and absolute calamity seems to always take place here, so I wouldn't be shocked to see him get up front in a hurry.
Of course, and calamity always brings forward a lot of predictions. I'm just going to go with a wild card here. I'm going to say that Ethan O'Connor may have a big shot to win this going into this, but outside of my predictions, he is very fast on this track, almost won, but Calamity Corner took over. Lamb Pipe, who do you believe could have the biggest shot to win here as the pace car gets ready to roll in?
You know, I like the 4 of Alex Morrill. He's really good on the road courses. He's starting pretty decently. I think he can be pretty capable of winning today.
All right, as the all 35 drivers roll towards the front stretch here at Autumn Hill, there's that Calamity Corner. We have seen plenty of the drivers slide off and hit into that wall. Could we see plenty of the drivers up front make that mistake? We'll have to see. But of course, as they roll, we'll get this Autumn race off right, boys. Green flag will wave. The cars will get into gear as we get ready to go green. And we are green flag racing now here at Autumn Hill.
Oh, early on, the 05 car. Gary Russell taking advantage of that inside line start. 21 kind of getting a run on him.
Seems like the 05 love machine has quite the speed here early on, but of course some of the mistake corners that you can make are within the S's, and especially within that wide stretch where you can go just a little further off the track limits to where they are on those rumble strips. You'll have to see and keep watch of those. You can see plenty of the field trying to keep their focus here early on. Leland Fife, a surprise front runner here with JD Fatal going in third, Ethan O'Connor in fourth, and Nate Wines in fifth. These guys have seemed to be pretty fast here early on, but we'll have to see later into the race here.
Yeah, early on, not necessarily guys you'd expect to be up here at these road courses, but some good equipment up here. Obviously a new team in Aurora Knights that Gary Russell is running with here in this 05 car. Leland Fife also in a new organization with Marinelli Muriel Racing. They've always had a pretty good, really past few seasons, they've had a pretty good road course program. And that is being shown off real well as he is going for the lead here.
As Leland Fife is currently just trying to find his line, trying to find where he can get the best runoff off the throttle into the brakes and lean into the throttle. He has seemed to take up the training on that road course pretty well. There's three wide back there, as it is Carter Jones, Tyler King, and it looks like the 10 of Dylan Jones. These guys are having quite the battle here in the back, but Tyler King with a wide runoff going into the entrance of one.
Yeah, and you'll see guys make those three wide moves all the time here, especially early on in this race. They need that track position very early on to have an opportunity, but a lot can happen in this race. A lot of mistakes can be made. They're made all over the place at Autumn Hill. The track is absolute chaos consistently every year. We'll see if that continues.
Of course, these guys are battling it out. As you can see, the 20 of C Packet, originally the car was meant to be from Simon Black, but he has been suspended for a few races. As you can see, Leland Fife now towards the lead. He has quite the distance on him. You can also see the number 4 of Alex Muriel in 6th. He is trying, or well, right now 5th to the standings. Tyler King.
First one to make that mistake. It's your champion. Whoa! Close call with DeVore there.
Tyler King has quite a issue with some of the road courses. He is the defending winner. Defending champion. As it seems like that 2X car had a little bit of issue going off into that apex, either over throttle or under throttle, going towards it, losing grip, and just sort of running into the final turn a little too loose from the looks of it. As you can see, Leland Fife starting to gain a little bit of distance between the car. The 05 car of Gary Russell is now there side by side. Justin Ricci gets an overpass on the number 4 of Alex Muriel.
I also noticed the 21 Roberto Crown Jr. up here. This is a driver who did not make it to Daytona, a team that came together at the last minute. He didn't really have a cup ride together. Brought in this organization kind of at the last minute. But here they are, and they are fast. No doubt about that. Strong showing for that team here.
Of course, speed is never truly anything of sort whenever it comes to road course racing. Oh, and it looks like Leland Fife nailed into the grass. Big mistake going in there. He hit his wheels hit the grass and the rumble strips. Sort of losing a lot of ground. Now Gary Russell once again to the point going across the turns here, as it looks like JD Fatal and Ethan O'Connor are battling it out for position back there, as the Aurora Knights machine has sort of been the biggest fighter in the Aminion group outside of the number 37, who has recently been told that he's no longer going to be racing with Brink, but is also going to go with JD Fatal's team at Racing Is Forever.
Yeah, pretty big for Aminion over there, especially with their showing here today, showing a lot of speed. So that's basically 3 out of the top 4 up here very early on. It's a new manufacturer and everything, and a completely rebranded, basically new organization in Racing Is Forever, bringing on a second entry just a few races into the season. So silly season seems to never truly end until about the end of the season. And that starts right back up again.
And once again, the battle for the lead is the 05 and the 5. These guys have been the top two competitors going into Autumn Hill. These guys have yet to hold their positions of the lead, hold the lead very well. Of course, you can see as well Alex Morrill in the Marinelli Racing Enterprise for a Red Bull car, trying to get around the 96 Slim Jim car of Jared Holmes. Jared Holmes has seemed to calm down his racing style. His arrogance has sort of not dwindled, but it has also been a little more humbled, of course, as you can still see there's quite the distance between 3 and 4 with P1 and 2.
And with the 96 last season, you know, you noticed a lot of actually support in the garage area wanting them to do well. And, oh, out of nowhere, out of a cannon, Ethan O'Connor. Right to the point.
Quite the shot that Ethan O'Connor had. It looked like either the 5 made a mistake, which cut up the number 05, but it also seems like Ethan O'Connor has quite the speed in that Pokemon car. He wants to try and get his second-to-last outing in the sport, or second-to-last outing in Brink. He wants to try and find his line, and now he wants to try and cap off his Brink run with a victory here. He is yet to shake off the 05 and the 5, but is also has failed to shake off plenty of the other drivers that are starting to make their line here.
And he made his comments earlier in the week about his time with the organization, talking about how he enjoyed it but wish they would have found more success. Obviously, a win today would help cement that time he has spent with the team. A team that has struggled to find victory lane in recent years.
Of course, it'll be difficult as side-by-side right now, Gary Russell and the 37 and Ethan O'Connor now just sort of in dead even spots, but right now Gary Russell has the advantage going into the final turn. The 37 runs it a little harder, but he will not try and run it too hard to go and hit into Calamity Corner. A little bit of contact between Leland 5 and 5 for second place.
And really, there's not one specific car in this race that is truly the fastest. There's just this big group of three or four guys up here. There's someone else who has a fast car we probably haven't even seen competing, contending for the lead just yet. All it takes is a yellow to come out to change everything.
And with a lot of the potential that these guys have, you can see plenty of the smaller names and some of the bigger names. It's rookies and veterans all across the board here. Gary Russell with a brand new manufacturer of a Minion trying to do well. These guys are fighting it out. The top five right now are seeming to hold it there, but you can also see Zach Stern starting to make some speed going across the turns. He wants to try and subjugate and also add on to the victory tally list that he has for season 3. And oh no, Gary Russell off. Slides off.
Yeah, no, Gary Russell has a
big mistake. He ran that car as hard as it could, and it seems like he ran it a little too hard going across that final turn and just slammed into the wall there.
Yeah, and I'm surprised that mistake hasn't been made more here today. It was definitely made a lot more often last time we were here, and even in the very recent bait race, you saw quite a bit of it, but I guess a lot of these drivers have learned from the mistakes of last season and cleaned up their act.
Of course, but like I've said, you can see some wily veterans. You can see teal and purple surrounding the blue car. The blue number 5 of Leland Fife. He has seemed to not like this very much, of course, but he seems to have calmed down for a little bit. He almost loses it going into that apex turn. JD Fatal trying to get around that number 5 there.
I watch out for this 8 and 14. They are coming. They've been shot right out of a cannon. They have been really fast these past two laps. Gotten right by the 5 there. It's only a matter of time before they catch this Brink 37.
never ever count out Brink whenever it comes to these sorts of things. Of course, you can hardly count out some of the cars here at all, especially when it comes to what we believe is the top contenders of the series right now. Ethan O'Connor wants to try and put his name out there and put his name in lights, so to say, early on into the race. We're close to about halfway, just about like two laps towards halfway, as JD Fatal started to make his line. What a drive that this Minion driver has. Of course, bringing a Minion into Racing is Forever, and of course, rebranding Burnout Club into such a race team. And so far, they are making it a cakewalk here at Autumn Hill.
Story of that team really has been crazy. He brought in three other drivers last season. Each of them would end up leaving the organization by season's end. And now we start the season off, one car team, bringing in somebody else few races in. And that driver he's bringing in is the one he's battling for the lead. And I think O'Connor made a mistake there, because now Fatal has taken it right away from the 37.
And it looks like he made the same mistake as Leland Fine, which caught him that position before, where he hit his tires onto the grass and had to try and get away from that. As caution is out, the lights are on. We'll have to see what brought out the caution here, but of course, it's going to be across the line. Fatal will be your leader, as you can see some of the drivers here, and it looks like Ethan Farley and Seth Peters.
Yeah, the 0 and the 78 there on Pitt Road. Didn't quite see what took place between the two of them, but that's really unfortunate for those teams considering their finishes at Daytona. Obviously, Peters went for the very wild ride down the backstretch in the big one. And Farley was also involved in that, so not a great start for those teams at all.
It's going to be difficult because Fireball Motorsports has been trying to capture some victory within the NABART. As you can see, the field's starting to pack up a little bit, get a little crazy trying just to line up. But it's big dependence on if they pit or if they don't. Oh, a little bit of contact between some of the drivers here. But the Elite has been... go ahead. Here.
No guarantee that we're going to get a yellow here. Any yellow could end the race. Yeah, really from the point forward of, you know, 5, 4, 3 laps to go in this race. This could be the only yellow. I would expect most, if not all, drivers to be going down pit road this time.
Of course, and it's going to be difficult, especially with some of the people that are trying to get their wheels off the ground and their names in quite big starts. The Elite have been trying to get off the ground as much as they could with Season 2 with the cars. Now they're back to a two-car operation with only Ethan Farley and Nate Wines in the mix. And Fireball Motorsports has been trying to gain a victory once again, trying to get some other Fireball Motorsports team, as it looks like Leland Fife and Zach Stern are making a strange pit strategy. Everybody else is pitting except for them.
Yeah, for the time being, they're staying out as Fatal leads everybody else in the field down. So what happened? Oh, that's a bizarre incident. Wow.
Oh.
God, that's just
hard lick.
That was a hit.
Yes, it was. We were hell of a hit. Playing pipe back to the booth. Not quite sure whose fault that was. I don't know if I've seen anything like that before.
That was I can't even put into words what that was. That was just,
I don't know.
It
if
looked
the
like whenever going into the turn
or what.
They just hit and something.
Obviously,
it looks like whenever the zero hit. Yeah, it just looked like whenever the zero hit into the number 32 there, he just kind of hit him a little too hard, lost control of the car. It either snapped loose or it got way tight, just lost it into the turn. Spun around.
It only took a split
second.
It took a split second him being on his right rear quarter panel for that to happen. I feel like maybe the splitter of the zero got caught in the tire, the right rear tire of the 32 of Evan Toddy. Maybe that's what caused that to happen, but I'm not too sure. Really, just a very odd reaction. Five and the eight are going down now.
Strange.
It looks like they're signifying that they're going to be pitting. That's what it looks to me.
But it makes no sense because the lights are off in the pace car to indicate the restart here. So we're going green while they're pitting.
I do not understand this call by the 5 and the 8.
The car will roll off.
This is
so
an interesting
one. Rolls off with Leland Fyfe and Zach Stern. And we're going to be going green. Fans are ready to go.
Looking into the stands, you can see some Leland Fyfe and Zach Stern fans confused by the call that the pit crew made, but if it had to be done, it had to be done. As the cars go green here, green flag waves once again. The restart of JD Fatal is stunning to look at. He has gained a little bit of ground going into it as some of the cars are scrambling around for the best line of the track here. But of course, it's going to be quite difficult just on fresh, cold tires coming into this.
Yeah, a lot of them fanning out here. Seven of Paul Donlan. Trying to make up ground, makes up quite a bit of it there just within that one corner.
Here comes the 20 of C Packet.
C Packet out of nowhere.
Quite the run from that team.
Yeah, I haven't really seen them all day. That's a very young driver in the race car, running full-time in the bait this season for Main Event Enterprises. Running the starts in the 20 car for the suspended Simon Black.
That would be huge for him and that team if they were able to put it together today.
I think he can see the writing on the wall there. He knows that he has the equipment to win, but he's seen how far back he had qualified. So I think he's using as much of his equipment as he will be willing to use to get up towards the front and stay far away from JD Fatal there. He knows the skill level of Fatal. He also knows that Ethan O'Connor and Paul Donlan are right there to capitalize if either or makes a mistake going into that final turn.
And this is a driver who's been in the series before. He attempted about half the season last year with Main Event Enterprises. Couldn't quite get that cup ride, but decided to compete for the Bait Championship. He has a feeling he'll be back in the NABAR full-time after this season, but he's just got to show off what he can do, and today would be a very good indicator of that. You just got to limit the mistakes.
I think any team owner looking to sign a driver, they should be watching this kid. He is something else.
And he came out of nowhere. He really did. Not a lot of people really noticed him. And he came out about midway point of last season. And he has been very solid. You know, nothing too flashy, but a performance like this could very much change that perception to him.
As Paul
Donald's making up some ground
just
here.
Fires. He just fired across. Now he's going to try and fight for the lead from C Packet. But C Packet looks like he's on a house of fire right now. He is trying to block wherever Paul Donlan can take full advantage of every apex turn. He has a shot to pass around, but Simon Black is just right there. Well, not Simon Black. C Packet has... it's a little difficult, but of course C Packet just... He did run half the season with Main Event Enterprises, but of course, Main Event Enterprises' equipment was not suitable for his skill level, especially with this. If you give him good equipment, he will absolutely run with it. Light a fire under him, he will become a firecracker.
Hoping to get an Abbott ride with that organization and a full-time seat at some point, but... This isn't quite the season. He'll be getting limited starts here. Who knows where else in the NABAR he'll be racing after his three starts with Ghost Motorsports are up. Could really be anywhere. A lot of teams have some openings coming up, so a lot of opportunities for him in the 15 races he'll be allowed to run. But he is he's pulling away. Coming to about 5 laps to go here.
You can see plenty of the drivers. You can now see Leland Fyfe and Zach Stern, who are far from comfortable. I think they were hoping that the next caution would come out early on so that they could just go towards the front while everybody else pitted, but it looks like the drivers are smart. You can see the distance, 1.35 away from that number 14 there. He wants to try and keep that distance as long as he can without any mistakes going across the four tires, but it looks like he made a mistake because here comes JD Fatal.
He's right there. He must have been slow coming out of the S's. He is right there. That could be the pass right here. I think these two are going to battle out for the win.
This is going to be a fantastic battle right here.
Towards the final turn, JD pushes him a little further up the track, but does not make him commit to Calamity Corner. He keeps it there, going towards the. He keeps it there. It's going to be very close across the line. 0.05. JD is the leader. He will finally clear out C Packet for that first position. C Packet will now have to try and chase down and hope that the 14 makes the same mistake he did across the same set of turns.
I also noticed substitute driver Brian Leon in the 83 car has made his way into the podium position. We'll see if he has the speed to get up there, but I haven't seen him all race long, and he's all of a sudden moving. Got right past the 7 car, and he is several car lengths ahead of him now. Ash Ellington is also up here, towards the top 5.
Sometimes it just takes a while for these cars to get figured out, but once they go, they can really get to moving.
JD Fatal with a mini on. It would be quite the endeavor if JD could pull one victory off for a mini on and a brand new manufacturer with a brand new team. These guys are looking quite dominant. You can see some of the bigger names like Justin Newman and, of course, Caleb Marinelli. He's trying his hardest. You can see the number 2X car of Tyler King just trying to race his way. It's a total of 3 laps to go are here tonight. You can see JD Fatal starting to gain ground from where that 20 is. So if JD makes a major mistake, it could be C Packet's night.
And I'm starting to doubt if that's going to be the case. I mean, he has been so flawless basically all day, taking advantage of others' mistakes. I don't know if I see that 14 car making a mistake for the rest of the day, but It's been a while since he's been able to find victory lane. This would be massive for this team and this manufacturer if he got it done.
It looks like C Packet was a little wide off entrance on the final turn. These guys are just trying to keep hold. You can see the same thing with Ryan Logano there in that Money Lion car. Some of the bigger just trying to get their popsicle sticks are in the air. 2 laps to go. JD Fatal is your leader with Simon or C Packet, Brian Leon, and the number 9 of Ash Ellington, and the 96 of Jared Holmes. That is your current top 5. As it looks like JD Fatal is just running himself on rails right now. Kept a hold of his car the entire day.
He has that car hooked up now.
Very hooked up, actually. Yeah.
He is ready. He can see that win. He's going to try to be flawless and give it everything he's got.
Fans are on their feet. He's going to take the white flag here, just about a corner.
As white flag, 1 lap to go for JD Fatal. Brand new manufacturer rebranded his entire team. And has put his full faith onto a mini on it with Racing is Forever. That 14 car looking sublime in that pink and teal car, or that purple and teal car with the HFC brand on top. It looks like nobody can touch JD Fatal going across the S's. He is flawless, untouchable here.
Sure, it certainly won't be the only paint scheme we see from him, but that thing right there sure is a beauty.
It is.
There's any car I wanted. If there was any JD Fatal car I wanted to see go to Victory Lane, it would be this one. Love it. Looks great in person.
Of course, and going across the final turns,
listen,
JD Fatal. That crowd is on fire right now. JD Fatal in the pink and teal. We'll have to change it to black and white. JD Fatal will come across the line and win at Autumn Hill.
Dominant run from him.
That was impressive. Absolutely flawless at the end. And that's what you got to be to win these things.
A lot of impressive runs to end this thing out.
Once again, what a finish for not only Racing Is Forever in that 14 with JD Fatal, but of course, the brand new manufacturer of a Minion. They had quite a run going on early on to the season with, but now they have a official win sticker going onto their car after this race. Man, what a way to show that you are a potential dominating force in the manufacturer market. As he makes his victory lap.
Quite a big fan base that F14's got. That's a driver that these fans have been wanting to see find success for a very long time. He had the one victory at Kansas two seasons ago.
One stat that I have noticed, the person who wins Autumn Hill tends to win the championship. But you can never make a prediction too early on, and you can never make a prediction too late into the season. Right now, JD has proven that not only a Minion is a dominating manufacturer with this race and this very clean victory at Autumn Hill, he may be able to fight for the cup, and he may be able to fight that trophy at season's end.
Like to get back there. This previous season was really more him from an owner's perspective, getting those other three cars competitive, which he was successfully able to do. And now this time it's really him, and now it'll be another driver as O'Connor takes over the 41, just two races away. This will definitely boost the confidence of this organization. We talked to any of these guys in the shop, and they love everything going on in the races forever. The vibe is so much better than it was before. The outlook, the optimism. This team knows it has something special, and it knew that this is going to be very, very soon.
Well, of course, as we are about ready to end off the broadcast, the congratulations big time to JD Fatal. And thank everybody here, and thank the owner of the NABBART. My name has been Emmett Freeman. This has been Rat Bastard and Lamb Pipe. We're here to sign you off. Y'all, have a good one.
See you next time.
It's hard to breathe. I need some space. Why you gotta put your problems on my plate? I don't believe a word you say. It's like every time you come around, I wish you'd go away. Cause I'm in too deep, I'm just trying to sleep. But you stuck in my bed, just laying undercover. Cause I'm in too deep, I'm just trying to sleep. But you stuck in my bed, just laying undercover. Again, laying undercover. Laying undercover, you laying undercover again. Laying undercover, laying undercover, you laying undercover again. Yeah, I don't wanna wake up. In the end, it's all on me. I'm not home, don't wait up. Why you gotta put your problems on my plate? I don't believe the words you say. It's like every time you come around, I wish you'd go away. 'Cause I'm in too deep, I'm just trying to sleep. But you stuck in my bed, just laying undercover. 'Cause I'm in too deep, I'm just trying to sleep. But you stuck in my bed.